Hello, welcome back to anatomy classes. Today we are going to do with the osteology of vertebrae. Vertebrae are the irregular bones which all join together to form the vertebral column. So there are 7 cervical vertebrae. So they are named based upon where they are present in the which region they are present. So the vertebrae which are present in the neck are called cervical vertebrae. There are 7 cervical vertebrae, and in the thoracic region where they articulate on the either side with the ribs are known as thoracic vertebrae. There are 12 thoracic vertebrae, and below the ribs the vertebrae here they are called as lumbar vertebrae. There are 5 lumbar vertebrae. And lumbar vertebrae last L5, the 5th lumbar vertebrae articulates with the single triangular like bone where the 5 sacral vertebrae fuses to form a single bone called as sacrum. And below the sacrum, the lower part of the sacrum articulates with a very small bone which is called as coccyx. Coccyx is formed by the fusion of 4 coccygeal vertebrae. So there are 7 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral and 4 coccygeal. Altogether there are 33 vertebrae. And these vertebrae on the posterior side you can see the projections which are called as the spinous process. So in lay term it is also called as spine because the spinous process is the most prominent feature of a vertebra. Developmentally, the vertebral column is from the somites, and the somites again divide into sclerotome, dermatome and myotome. So the sclerotome part of the somite gives rise to vertebra. So these vertebrae all joins to form vertebral column, and they form a curvature which concavity towards the anterior side and convex towards the posterior side. This is called as primary curvature, which is formed during the development of the embryo. And after birth, after 6 to 7 months after birth, the child starts holding its neck. When the child starts holding its neck, in the cervical region, we can see the convexity towards the anterior side and concavity towards the posterior side. So this is a secondary curvature which is formed after birth, 6 to 7 months after birth. This is called cervical curvature. Similarly, there is in adults, if we see, so here is the cervical part with the cervical curvature which is formed after birth, and similarly the curvature which is formed in the lumbar region after birth. When the child starts walking, that is after 1 year to 1.5 year after birth, when child starts walking, so we can see one more secondary curvature which appears in the lumbar vertebra. So the primary curvatures are retained in the thoracic region and in the sacral region. So this is about the curvatures of spine. Neck region, the cervical vertebra makes an anterior bend which is called as cervical curvature, and in lumbar region it makes an anterior convexity which is called as lumbar curvature. And dorsally, the thoracic region is dorsally curved and sacral it is dorsally curved. So the thoracic curves and the sacral curves, they are the remnants of primary curvatures, and the rest cervical and lumbar are formed due to the secondary curvatures. Cervical curvature is formed when the baby starts holding its neck, that is 6 to 7 months after birth, and lumbar curvature is formed when the baby starts walking, that is around 1 to 1.5 year after birth. So let's see the individual vertebrae. These vertebrae are the irregular bones which are present in the vertebral column. There are 7 cervical and 12 thoracic. This is the thoracic vertebra. Here is the lumbar vertebra. 5 sacral vertebra joins to form sacrum. So let's see the features of any typical vertebra. If the features, the vertebra has got a body. This is the body of the vertebra. and each body is again having four surfaces: superior surface and inferior surface, anterior surface and posterior surface. And the rest of the vertebra apart from the body is called as vertebral arch. The gap between the vertebral arch and the body, here where I am keeping the forceps, it is the vertebral canal. So the vertebral canal is the site where the spinal cord, cauda equina, along with its meninges passes through. The parts of the vertebral arch, the first parts on the either side is the pedicel. These two pedicles joins the vertebral arch to the body. So on the either side we can see the transverse process. These two are the transverse process which are present in the vertebra. And the transverse process, if we trace the transverse process, they converge to form a flat sheet of bone which are called as laminae. The laminae further converge to form a projection which is called as the spinous process. And there are two processes projecting up bearing the articulating facets which are called as two superior articulating facets. Similarly, there are two facets on the inferior side of the vertebra which are called as inferior articulating process bearing inferior articulating facets. So totally there are seven processes. The seven processes are two superior articulating process bearing two superior articulating facets, two inferior articulating process bearing two inferior articulating facets. So totally four processes. On the either side we can see two transverse process, so six processes, and seventh process is the spinous process. So these are the parts of any typical vertebra. And the body above, it articulates with the intervertebral disc to articulate with the preceding vertebra, and inferiorly it articulates with the intervertebral disc of to articulate with the succeeding vertebra. Let's see how to differentiate these vertebras, which is very important for us to identify them. So how to identify a cervical vertebra? Here if you see a cervical vertebra which is in my hands, the transverse process is identified by a foramen. We can see a foramen present inside the transverse process. This foramen is called as foramen transversarium. Where I have probed is the foramen transversarium. So foramen transversarium is the important unique feature of a cervical vertebra. The other feature is the spine. The spine, if we identify, it is short and it is bifid. It divides into two. So bifid spine and foramen transversarium. By seeing these two features, we can say it as a cervical vertebra. Next is the thoracic vertebra. The thoracic vertebra is identified by facets present over the body. There are facets which are present over the body. So the pointed things are the facets. Here we can see the facets. The facets can be complete or demi-facets. So by seeing the facets, we can identify them as thoracic vertebra. And here the spine is oblique and directed downwards. And here is the lumbar vertebra. Comparatively, it is larger to the other vertebra. And if you see, it has got a very large body. And lumbar vertebra is identified by not having foramen transversarium and by not having the facets over the body. So if you see the transverse process here, there is in the transverse process, and over the body also there are no facets, either demi-facet or complete facet, there are no facets over the body. So by seeing there are no facets, we can identify it as a lumbar vertebra. It is a quite large vertebra. And the spine is quadrilateral. Here the spine is quadrilateral in shape and the body is quite large, kidney shaped body. So this is lumbar vertebra. And sacral vertebra, all the sacrum joins to form a single bone here which is called sacrum altogether. Coccygeal usually attaches to the sacrum, which is a small bone here, very small compared to the sacrum. 4 coccygeal vertebrae joins to form a coccyx. So this is the coccyx and here is the sacrum. So these are the main differentiating features to how to identify a vertebra. Thank you. I hope you all like this session and it is would be useful for you all for your practical exam. And don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and don't forget to press the bell button for further notifications. Bye.